Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death, your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this confession, I, by virtue of my office, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all you. And in the standing by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
Merciful Lord, you did not spare your only Son, but delivered him up for us all. Grant us courage and strength to take up the cross and follow him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the 13th Sunday after Pentecost is from Deuteronomy chapter 30. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life, death, blessing, and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to give him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night.
He is like a tree planted by streams of water, that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and all that he does he prospers.
The wicked are not so, but are like the chaff that the wind drives away.
Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish.
The epistle is from Philemon. Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, a brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Aphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what you require, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, of your own free will. For this, perhaps, is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you receive me. If he has wronged you at all, or owes you anything, charge that to my account, say nothing of your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you, the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident in your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It's thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
God the Father, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Ever suffer from boredom? I used to rate the movies that I watched for how long it took me to fall asleep. Everybody has sat through a teacher's class, the teacher is saying important things, and because of his tone of voice, or in one particular case, I remember a professor who seemed to do it all in history as a 11th plane, and would speak in detail about every single thing and not pick out peaks and valleys. Oh my goodness, I couldn't make it 10 minutes through the class without my mind wandering. Well, you know. Perhaps you're one of those people. So I join you, who, when you hear the words grace and peace to you from God the Father and so on and so forth, it's like cowbell ringing a bell. But instead of salivating, it's like attention starts to water. And I'm not saying any words. When that doesn't be true, but there's also an issue here that we need to consider. And it is boredom with the Word of God. Jesus seems to take it as an issue as well, because he witnessed it in his own disciples. Recall the night of his arrest. Kind of a dramatic time, kind of an important time. You think those disciples would be wide awake and watchful, and yet Jesus has to come back from prayer and say, wake up, the sluggards. Important stuff is happening. But it happens to them, and it's happened to us as well. And Jesus knows us well, and he speaks the words that we hear in our text today. Did they pass by you because you've heard them before and you're a little bit bored by them? If so, listen to some of this. How shocking this is. Great crowds accompanied him. He turned to them and said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters and yes, even his own life, cannot be my disciple. Not, should not, or may I recommend to you another path of life. But you can't be my disciple unless you hate those in your own family and hate yourself. So much for self-esteem, right? What word does Jesus say? And can this be the same God who says to us, honor your father and your mother? We have this bait switch here. I think what's happening is what the great 20th century novelist Flannery O'Connor wrote about. She said this: when you can assume that your audience holds the same beliefs you do, you can relax and use more normal means of talking to them. When you have to assume that it does not, then you have to make your vision apparent by shock. To the hard of hearing, you must shout. And for the almost blind, you draw large and startling figures. In other words, Jesus' audience, for the most part, be they Pharisee, Sadducee, tax collector, or sinner, shared the same worldview, the same religious point of view. The one from the side of the proud and arrogant, and the other from the side of the despised. And so Jesus uses this figure of speech, this way of talking, to draw those large figures. You're not understanding me if you think I have come simply to say to you, you need to do better at honoring your father and your mother, and you need to love God more than you do. That's what you think I came to say. You know, firm up the law a little bit for you. Shore up the building because the foundations are getting a little shaky, guys. Then you misunderstand what Jesus is saying. He is saying, I have come to tear down the building, to destroy it. I'm building a new thing. When I go to the doctor, well, I guess sometimes when I'm filling out the forms, I'm a little bit bored. But when he comes in after the exam and says, this is what I diagnose, he has my attention. All of it. In fact, I ask questions to make sure I understand what he wants me to do. understands their self-love. He understands their religious prejudices and their assumptions. He knows that it's easy to become bored with the faith. And he knows in many of these cases it's not faith at all. So he draws the shocking comparison. You need to pick up your cross, not the one that you choose and put in your pocket and rub it once in a while because it's like a rabbit's foot or something like that. The cross that I put on you. And crosses, you're going to find out, are painful and humiliating and crushing. And that's what I'm going to put on you. Hey, you large crowds that are following me. Still want to do that? Or do you want to count the cost? We're part of that crowd, aren't we? We claim to follow Jesus the Messiah. We've been baptized into his name. He has made us one with him. He delights in us. His blood has covered our sin. His body and blood nourish us, feed us. We are his disciples. But me in the classroom or movie theater, you wherever it happens to you, we start to take things for granted. We get a little bored. We've heard it all before. Even the shocking news that God died on the cross, that it was his sacrifice that opens heaven to us, can become just another thing. It's then time to beware and be warned. We cannot lay down the cross that our Savior has placed upon us for all reasons because it no longer interests us. This very thing should wake us up. By the way, I notice also that when I go to the dentist, he has my full attention, especially when he's drilling. The pain is the thing that gets my attention. Now, your cross, take that suffering that is laid upon you and bear it. Because that is one of the ways that God gets your attention and teaches you and me that fidelity to him and to Jesus is the thing that counts. And ultimately, it is the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross that counts. It is the only thing that remains. This word of forgiveness. This word that gives us life and salvation. That is the thing that we cling to. Except that we are weak. No better than Jesus' disciples were, or the people to whom Paul wrote, or the author to the Hebrews, who says, straighten those weak knees. Because the temptation is there. Let's test it out. See how it works. Remember those striking figures, those loud shouts? Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It's thrown away. What's Jesus talking about here? It's shocking when you realize that, you know, that salt does not lose its effectiveness. You can't let salt sink. I guess if you have iodized salt, but salt is a mineral. It ain't going away. If you consider salt to be the word of God, the word of God is effective, always. But there are things that we do that change it for us. I suppose one of them is if you eat so much salt and your taste buds can become nearer to it. I don't know if that's it. But I certainly know that if I dilute salt with water or some other substance, its saltiness is eventually going to go away. Right? If I put a teaspoon of salt in a cup of water, I'm going to notice that. But what if I put that teaspoon of salt in, say, 5 gallons of water? I wonder if I'd even notice. And so often we dilute the word of God. And I think that's when it begins to become boring to us. There's so many other important and interesting things to do in life. Or some more water. We have so many worries and concerns that demand our time and our attention. We're a little more. We don't have time. time for the services at God's house or for personal devotions, and we neglect them, pour in a little more water. And suddenly, what happens to that salt? Not the salt's fault, but it becomes useless to and for us. We don't even bother to spit it out anymore. We just ignore it. That's a grave sin. Because back to the doctor's analogy, when the doctor talks to you, it's about life and death, isn't it? Unless you have a little aggravating hand in or something like that. He's on, she's on important things. And Jesus is on about important things. Life, death. A good confirmation of that is our Old Testament reading. What do you want, people? Do you want life and good, or do you want death and evil? It's that stark of choice. Do the will of the Lord, life. Disobey, ignore, throw away, death. What do you choose? Well, the Israelites chose life, of course, and then they went about proving that they really didn't. And so do we. We know we want life. We know we want salvation through Jesus Christ. And we know He has given it to us freely. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But God has given us Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of the world. And so we have been forgiven in Him. But we need to have, what does Jesus say? He who has ears to hear, let him hear. So let the warning stand. Beware of boredom. Beware of taking things for granted. Beware of just assuming that your way into heaven is assured. So assured that you don't even need to pay attention to it anymore. You do. You do. The good news is Jesus was arrested, saw him die, rose again. And those very disciples who fell asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane were confronted with the living Christ and given a word of condemnation, of forgiveness and redemption. That is the word for us, and that is the final word. But we have our sins and we struggle against them. The greatest triumphs, Jesus triumphs, and life triumphs. Rejoice in that. Read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest the Word of God. But that is where you find that triumph, that salvation, that forgiveness, and that life. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our service continues with the Nicene Creed. We stand.
Ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and He
give his life on the cross. Inspire us to trust in his sacrificial victory, that we would follow in his way through death into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
you hear our prayer.
Divine Shepherd, you give life to your church through your word. Grant your people to walk in your way. Bless our preschool this new school year. Watch over teachers, aides, students, and parents, and feed them with your word. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good Lord, we commend to you all who bear office in our land, and ask you to bless them and those they serve. Remember those in need of honest labor and daily bread, and give people employment according to your good and gracious will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, give the strength of the Spirit to all who are suffering or in any kind of need, especially to those we have been asked to remember, including Jeff, Kathy, Nancy, and Marilyn, Tom, Sharon, and Mary, Cindy, Missy, John, Bernadette, Renee, Emily, Dee, Billy, Dan, Mel, Inez, Bonnie, and George, that they may all have the courage and will to take up their crosses and follow you through suffering into life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, who all to your Son gives us his own body and blood, grant that all who receive the sacrament might do so with prepared and penitent hearts, rejoicing in your gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation for the sake of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Preserve us, O Lord, from all temptation, and grant us faith that we may rest all our prayers and the desires of our hearts in your merciful arms, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For
take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
would strengthen us for the same, in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Questions if you have. God's blessings.